Isaiah chapter 5. Let me sing for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved has a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and he cleared it of stones. He planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it. He hewed out a wine vat in it. And he looked for it to yield grapes, but he yielded wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I had not done in it? When I looked to it to yield grapes, what did it yield? Wild grapes. And now, I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its head, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its walls, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or pruned. Its briars and thorns shall grow up. I will also command the clouds, and they will not rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasant planting. And he looked for justice, but behold, blessing. And righteousness, but behold, an anger. Lord God, you are a faithful God, and you have done a mighty thing. Because you have come to the vineyard. The gospel, Lord, you did not bear fruit. You did not produce what you desired. But there is good news. The good news is that Christ is here. And when he dwells in his vineyard, which is yours, he will produce a kingdom. So Lord, let us be grateful for the work and the power of God in us through Christ Jesus. Help us to heed the words that we are about to read and to look at. Help us to understand that all of us play a role in pruning and in growing and in helping your garden to flourish, and many of us are suffering. We bow for our own authority. We seek our own abilities to be exalted. We want to meet our own desires and face the connectivity. So we've been working through the Gospel of Mark. And you'll recall, we are kind of in what's known as the Passion Week, and Jesus has been triumphantly, declared as this great one who would come and who would reign. People were shouting his praises, laying cloaks before him. He comes in there and he examines what's happening in the temple. He sees that the time is up for the temple and he leaves. He returns again to the temple. This time he is there teaching with power and authority. He's flipping tables. He's driving the money changers and the people who are taking advantage of the worshipers out of the temple. He is standing, stopping the act of sacrifice. The Sanhedrin, the rulers of the temple, have traditions obviously with that. Last week, we saw this conflict bubble up as Jesus returned again to the Temple Mount. The Sadducees this time are asking the question, but by whose authority do you do these things? By whose power gives you the right to do these things? There's this conflict about authority, Jesus' authority versus their authority. Today, as we look, Mark chapter 12, Jesus is telling a parable, and he's speaking still to those same men, primarily to the south of the Sanhedrin, the ruling body. There's others there who are listening in as well. If you have a Bible, flip over to Mark chapter 12. Jesus tells a parable. Sometimes it's called the parable of the vineyard, but it's better described as the parable of the tenants, the people who were working there. This
is the only parable in Mark's gospel that is not found in chapter 4. Chapter 4 is literally weeks and weeks ago, if you think about it for us. But it's, you know, chapters back. We're in chapter 12. Chapter 4, there are a whole bunch of parables. This one parable is found right smack in the middle of the Passion Week. And the fact that it is not in chapter 4 and it's found right here should signify that there's some significance to it. There's something about this parable that is important to see when you look at that last week of Jesus' life. The parable also reveals, once again, that Jesus is fully aware of what's in store for him in just a couple of verses. He knows the leader's intention, he knows the want him dead. The story is about the relationship between Jesus and the leader. So, if you have a Bible, check this out. If you don't have a Bible, feel free to grab one of those in front of you. It will also be up on the screen. Mark chapter 12, verse 12. And he began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard, and he put a fence around it, and dug a pit for a wine press, and he built a tower, and leased it to the tenants, and he went into another country. When the season came, he sent a servant to the tenants to get from them some of the food of the vineyard. And they took him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. Again, he sent them another servant, and they struck him on the head, and they treated him shamefully. But he sent another, and him they killed. And so with many others, some they beat, and some they killed. He had still one other, a beloved son. Finally, he sent him to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But those tenants said to one another, "This is the end. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." They took him and they killed him, and they threw him out of the vineyard. What will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyard to others. Have you not read this scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing. This is marvelous in our eyes. And they were seeking to arrest him, but feared the people. For they perceived that he had told the parable against them. So they left him and went away. There's been this conflict over authority. And Jesus shares a parable that is dealing with authority. But it also shows something that is extremely beautiful. Church, the Father, the owner of the vineyard, is gracious and perfect. We see that in this parable. He is gracious and perfect. Jesus shares it. And he's sharing this parable because they already know what this parable is about. And if you recall, just a few brief moments before I prayed, I was reading from the book of Isaiah as God is speaking to the nation about this vineyard, and it almost lays exactly on what Jesus is saying. Those who were listening to Jesus' words, they knew that a vineyard was an allegory for Israel. They knew it was God, the Father, who was the one who was planting the vineyard, who was the owner of it. They knew that he had prepared the soil, that he had laid down the vines just right so that they would get what they needed in a single area. It seems that God has taken precaution to construct a wall around the vineyard to keep it from being attacked, to keep it from wild animals coming and eating fruit before the people could get to it, to protect the vines from the trees. He dug out a wine press. Everything that could be possibly needed to produce an abundant, fruitful crop, God had laid out. He did it all. He even constructs a tower to serve as her pastor. Might be just a thousand square. Everything's set. He put tenants in the kingdom to take care of them. Leaders who will watch over the vines so that they would grow and be cared for and nurtured so that they would produce the abundant fruit. Everything was set. The vineyard had everything it needed. All the prepared, even before the tenants take up residence. I really want this point because they have done nothing. These tenants, these leaders who have the responsibility of keeping over the vineyard, they haven't planted, they didn't put any of the wall, they didn't do anything. All they did was agree to the covenant with God. We will care for the vineyard. It was rules, it was stipulations, it was an understanding that when the harvest came, a portion of this would go back to you, the owner. All of it was prepared before even God did. In God's grace, the owner of the vineyard provided everything. Nothing was missing, nothing was lacking. It was prepared to produce an abundant crop. A covenant was made, an agreed upon portion would be surrendered back to the owner. So it was no surprise, there wasn't any shock when, you know, they look off in the distance and they're coming down the path as a servant, coming through the gate to his master's vineyard, coming to seek what was due, the agreed upon amount, to bring it back to his master. But instead of fulfilling the covenant promise to the leaders, the tenants in the vineyard, instead of returning gratitude and thanks for everything that the owner has already provided for them, they beat the servant and they send him back to the vineyard. But look how God responds. This is 4 and 5. And again, he sent them another servant, and they struck him on the head, treated him shamefully. And he sent another, and he struck him, and him they killed, and with many others, some they beat, and some they killed. So, do you see how the owner is long suffering, but patient? He just, I'll send another one. I'll send another one. They've got to listen to this guy. I'll send another one. But the fact is, seems about to escalate. They're freeing the messengers worse and worse and worse and worse as each one comes rolling down the hill into the vineyard. These are the words of God from Jeremiah chapter 7. God says to the nation of Israel, verse 25, 26, they did not obey or incline their ears, but walked in their own counsel and the stubbornness of their evil hearts, and they went back and not forward. From the day that your fathers came out of the land of Egypt to this day, I have persistently sent all my servants, the prophets, to them, day after day. Yet they did not listen to me or incline their ear, but stiffened their neck. They did worse than their fathers. To the nation of people, I'm sending messengers, I'm sending my servants, I'm sending people to you to get you in line, to help you to do what is right, to honor me, to be faithful. And what do? You serve me. Do you see how gracious God is to you? See his patient character. be three strikes and you're out in baseball. It might be three strikes and you're out in your own home. But when it comes to God, it's not three strikes and you're out. There are some folks, maybe some of you who are sitting this morning, within this church, and there's some folks we know outside this church, who have a wrongful idea of God. They accuse Him of being an angry, vengeful God. Let me clear you. God is angry for sin. God does say vengeance is mine. But this is a God thing. He's got this grace. God isn't in heaven with a thunderbolt of hand, ready to throw it down to smite you. They're missing, and this is you, they need to see that, the God is just ready to pounce on you as soon as you do something wrong. Please don't forget, don't ignore. God is perfect, loving you. Let me tell you, don't do this again. He is calling us to repent and to experience full forgiveness. He is doing that now. He is being patient now. He is being gracious now. I want to see that in. There will be a time. Perhaps you're familiar with 2 Peter. Chapter 3, verse 9, and the Apostle Peter says this: "The Lord is not slow to fulfill His promises, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance." He's being patient now. He's sending messengers and servants to the vineyard again and again and again. Why? Because He wants them to repent. He wants them to humble themselves and realize, we've been foolish for acting this way towards you. Interesting enough, is so many of us have this view that God is a patron. I grew up in the church, and I remember thinking, if God commands it, that means fun won't be part of it. If God wants something, that means He's stealing something or taking something from me. But that's not the reality. I mean, if you look at the picture, if they would just be obedient to God, all they were doing was offering back to Him a small portion of the fruit. But everyone would have an abundance of joy. The owner would be satisfied because they were faithful to the covenant. The tenants, the owners, would have more than enough from the fruit of the vine. The very vines themselves would flourish and grow. There's no rotting, there's no spewing. He is being gracious, He is being kind, He is being patient, because He wants the vineyard and the tenants to thrive. The problem is that the murder of servants, Paul, we read in verse 6, that the father of this son, the owner of the vineyard, wants to send his only son. And again, this is what I want to encourage you, your Christian. You probably read this passage. You're familiar with it. You're like, okay, I know who this one is. Just move on. Just kind of know how it ends. And just, okay, we're done. But stop here for a second. I'm the father of four sons. I would not send any of them to this thing. You know, I wouldn't be like, all right, there's a vineyard, we got three more. So, I wouldn't do that. You read this, that the defense is only sin. Why? Why would you do that? I mean, are you an idiot? I mean, if you've read this before, you just kind of blow right by this. But if this is the first time reading it, you would probably be like, That dude is stupid. Why would he do that? There's got to be something wrong with him. No, there's nothing wrong with him. He is a gracious father. He is a good king. He is a patient owner. That's why he sent his son. Not that the son doesn't come with weapons. The son comes humbly, just like all the other servants. The father graciously sent his only beloved son. We should ask ourselves, why? After everything that has occurred, why would we do that? It doesn't make any logical sense. But you have to also understand, since that the son, because he is the son and not a servant, comes with a different position, comes with a different authority. The son possessed a legal right to all of the vineyard. He had a legal right that the servants didn't have. He had a legal right, if you will, that the prophets or the other men of God who had done before him did not carry. Setting the servants was appealing to their moral integrity. You know what you agreed to. Follow through with it. And that's kind of what's happening with the servants. But when you send the son, what you're appealing to is the law. The law says, you agree to this contract. The law says, this is his. Now, you can have two different responses when the law comes to you. And some of us, with certain laws, we echo the words of the psalmist, Psalm 1, who says that he delights in the law, and we see that it's good, and it helps us to thrive, it protects us. But I think most of us, we don't delight in the law. We don't bow to the wisdom of it. Instead, we obey it when the law comes close. For example, why do we go from 80 to 50? I'm going to say 29 when there is a call in the meeting. Because you get close to the law. So close that you go even under the law. Right? And that drives me nuts. Just drive a few of them. Okay? Realize you don't want to do 80 anymore, but just drive a few. Why? Why is it that when kids are fighting and fooling around, as soon as they hear the law coming down the stairs, all of a sudden there's nothing wrong? What happened? The law is real. It is clear. But we want to heed it. Not because we morally agree with it. I mean, again, most of you are speeding. There are definitely roads we have driven on, and you're thinking, why is this 25 miles per hour? Well, one of my favorites is here in St. Joe. Why do we have a stop sign and the side street doesn't? It should be located. Like, we should need to keep it. It doesn't make sense. But why do I stop? Because I don't want to pay for it. Not because I think it's right and good. But God, His law is right and good. So when it comes near us, it shouldn't be, I'm just going to do it because I don't want wrath, or I'm just going to do it because I don't want to be punished. We should do it because it's good. There's benefit, there's blessing. The Son was sent by the Father to fulfill the law, to keep the commandments, the covenant of you. He's not coming to say, hey, you know you should do the right thing. He's coming to say, here it is. Your business is right there. Follow through. In the parable, verses 6 through 8, when the Son is sent, what we see here is Christmas and Easter all wrapped up together. He's come in grace to help them do the thing that we're all about. And what did they do? They kill him and they throw him out of the vineyard. The Son was sent by the Father to fulfill the law, but he was also sent as an act of compassion. Here's the law. We'll forgive you if you obey it. He sends the Son as an act of compassion. Compassion for the penitent. Compassion for the vineyard. The Father so yearns to see something beautiful be produced out of the vineyard that he has planted and that he has put these people over. He sends the Son so that all would experience the fullness of the vineyard. He came to rescue the tenants from their foolishness. But they say, no, I don't want your grace. I don't want your compassion. And they kill him. The tenants no longer are satisfied with just the produce that they have and what the land expects. They're no longer satisfied with the covenant that they made. They want the power, they want the control, they want the authority. The entire thing is established by the Father and the Savior to get him. If they killed the Son, all of it would be gone. Many of us echo that feeling today. If we could just cast off and kill the Son, we could be the gods. We could be the gods. Perhaps you're familiar with the German philosopher, Friedrich Nietzsche. But he declared, God is dead. God is dead. And that's how you think. All you have to do is flip on the TV, tune into the news for a little bit, and you'll see we live in a world that is continuing to pursue any news to bring something to. Even in the church, there are people who say, we go to a church, and you look at the church and say, the God is the authority in the church. You yourself are. You cast off the structures and the things that God has called his people to do because you want your own system. You want your own rule. You want your own authority. You want your own power. You don't want them. This act is dangerous. Storing up wrath. The gospel position of love and grace, the Father sends his Son to you. Say, don't you do this? In verse 9, Jesus asks his listeners, look there in verse 9, what will the owner do? Imagine for a moment that if you were able to connect with Dina Thomas and go there, and you're sitting in that crowd as Jesus is interacting. He's telling this parable. Can you imagine that piercing soul look that Jesus started giving to his readers at that time, as he kept looking in their eyes, but really looking into the depths of their soul, and he says, what will we want to do? They know who they are. They know who they are. They know what they are. They know of God's judgment. They know of Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 to 7. That he's going to tear down the walls and wild animals are going to come and destroy the vineyard. They know what's going to happen. They know what Jesus is speaking about. They know that there's a tenant. They know that they're being condemned. And Jesus says, have you not read this scripture? stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing. I read earlier from 1 Peter chapter 3. I want to look at it again because although it's a very encouraging verse, there's also some weight behind it. 2 Peter chapter 3, we see God's patience, we see his grace, but look at what Peter writes the verses later. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not looking that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. It's encouraging, isn't it? That you see happening right here, right now, that you know, he's sending the messengers, he's sending his own son, he's being patient, he's being gracious, he doesn't want any to perish, but then he goes on. The day of the Lord will come like a thief, and the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done in it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening for the coming day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolve, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. Don't be impatient now with how you respond to the Son that is set by the Father will impact what happens to you this week. Leaders listening to this parable, and perhaps some of you even today, are behaving just like the tenants. God has blessed you with so much that you show no gratitude or thankfulness for the work that you've done. In fact, perhaps you're sitting here right now hearing my words. To reject the Son of God. To do that is to literally cast away your life. Matthew chapter 23, verses 29 to 39, Jesus talking to Pharisees, some Pharisees are in this group that he's doing. He's having this terrible conversation with. I don't have time to read all 23, but if you are familiar with Matthew 23, 7 times Jesus says, "Woe to you." But here, verse 29 says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you build the tombs of the prophets and you decorate the monuments of righteousness, saying, 'If we had lived in the days of our fathers, we would not have taken part with them in the shedding of the blood of the prophets.'" And Jesus is saying, you make these great, you know, statues and monuments, and you declare, well, if we lived back then, we would have not been as dumb as our parents were to reject them. And Jesus does what Jesus does. Verse 31, "Thus you witness against yourselves that you are sons of those who murdered the prophets. Filling up then the measure of your fathers, you serpents, you breed of vipers. how are you to escape being sentenced to hell? Therefore, I send you prophets and wise men and scribes, some of whom you have killed and crucified, and some you will flog in your synagogues and persecute from town to town, some that you may come all the righteous. So, verse 35, so that you may come all the righteous blood shed on earth, from the blood of the righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah the son of Barakiah, whom you murdered between the sanctuary and the mountain. Thus I say to you, all these will come upon this generation. And this is the word of Jesus. From Jerusalem to Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to them. How often I would gather you children together as a hen gathers the brood under her wings. But you are not willing. For your house is left desolate. I tell you, you will see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Judgment will come. You might be able to say, like the Pharisees or the scribes at the time, we would never act that way. And then Jesus says, you are not. You are creating people who speak the word of God. And Jesus knows eventually they will kill him. Listen carefully to what Jesus is trying to convey in this parable. He is God's ultimate. There are no more sons to come after. There are no more perfect, holy, righteous ones who could fully do what was incapable for you to do. There is no gospel. There is no good news without Jesus. There is no hope without Jesus. There is no life apart from him. If you cast off Jesus, you are throwing away your only means to reconcile with the owner of the vineyard. As the sovereign creator of all things, God has the right to act, and he will act in ways that are good and righteous and holy, and sometimes means the slaughter of rebellious people. It is good. We know it's good. Hebrews 10:31, the writer says, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Judgment will come. God is laying it out right here. So if you know it full well, he is doing it because he wants you. In 2 Peter 3, he desires that none of you would perish. That you would hear the call, come now. You don't know what that is. Come now. There's something really amazing that I don't know if the Pharisees or the scribes or even the people have picked up on it. But in Isaiah chapter 5, the vineyard is walled and torn down. The wild animals covered it and destroyed the vineyard. But Jesus twists the kettle of the vineyard. Look at this lesson. What will the owner of the vineyard do? No picture. Instead, Jesus says, he, God, the owner, the Father, will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyard to us. But that's what he's doing. The Father's marvelous doing. He isn't just wipe out all of God's people. This is
done to the mood of the world.
Take a look here at verse 10 and 11. There is a beautiful help in these verses. These verses come from Psalm 118, which is also where the word comes from when they say, Hosanna, Hosanna, the highest. Jesus is coming down. These verses come from the same Psalm. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. Jesus' rejection, his humiliation, the stripes that would mar his body, his death on a tree outside the walls of the city, are used by God for a purpose that is far greater than anyone could imagine at that time, and I think, honestly, any of us even now. Christian, when you gaze upon the grace of God to send the Son to die for the sake of the vineyard, What they meant for evil, God has used most graciously, most compassionately, as a gift to all who would receive it. God wins. Even when it seems like everything's wrong, the sight of love comes to the world. The love is the coming of the sun of the act of the sun in grace. It is the death of the sun. The resurrection of the Son, the act of compassion and goodness, marvelous in the universe. I pray that we will see the power of God and His might through the gospel of Christ. Sin is hopeless. The vineyard won't be destroyed. In fact, it's going to grow and blossom even greater than they could ever imagine or even fathom, because what God will do through this Son, who they slaughtered and threw out of the vineyard, He will rise again, He will come back, He will take over the power and the authority and reign over what is rightfully His, and He will gather wild branches. Most of us, because I believe most of us believe that we do not have a lineage that goes back to Jacob. We cannot be Jesus. Most of you are wild branches. You are actually outside of the walls of the vineyard. And the man that they threw outside of the walls rose again and said, of the vineyard doesn't destroy it. He expands it by grafting people in. He brings those who are not his people and he makes them his people by the Son that they rejected. How marvelous is that in the eyes of the Redeemer? Is that the Bible? Flip over to Psalm 118. I think we have it on the screen as well, but I'm going to read these verses, just verses 19 to 29. And And think about this. I'm glad that Ron did the prayer. Because if you get here regularly, you know when Ron gets up here to the prayer, he always says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad." Because the rest of the matter is God made this day. And this is the grace of stuff right there. The fact that you get up this morning is a grace from God. And you should be grateful. But that phrase is from this passage, and it's actually talking about a day that is far greater than today. So we worship and we're grateful for today because we see in today God's grace, His mercy, His goodness, His kindness, His forgiveness, His redemption, His hope, His joy. That we see today, looking for that greater day when that will happen. We see that here. Psalm 118, verse 19. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I might enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone the builder has rejected, has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us. Bind up the festival sacrifice with cords up on the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures for me. And I will remind all of us, the Son has been sent. That is glorious news. Today, heed him. Don't kill him. Draw him up by the words. Rejoice in him. And experience the good news of him. It is insanity to kill his son. But also see the good news. You have cast them off again and again and again and again. Today, you don't have to. And all of this again. All of this, how bad it is. All of this again. But I thank you for it. From the depths of our heart, we feel that we are nothing in rebellion. We don't want to come, we don't want to stay, we want to live our own way. So, God, I pray that you would help us to see, maybe for the first time, the depth, the reality that judgment will come to those who reject the Son. I pray that it is. Somebody here who has looked at their life and said, I have been trying to throw off God. I've been trying to kill God. I've been trying to put myself as far away because I want to reign over my own life that they would see the power of it. But they would use today celebrating the glory that the Son has come and they would be rejected by God. And those who stand in Christ. Thank you.
church for those of us who never did. Let us look at the past and come to the truth to see your own son to us with that rich sin. How marvelous it is that he would take wild branches and graft it in. Marvelous it is that you continue to forgive. Marvelous